मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, Are you able to see the PPT screen? Sri, open it. So what we discussed yesterday, why Swati? Can you inform your classmates to join the class? Because very less number of students are joined. Shall we start the class or they are joining the class? In the previous class, we discussed. We started with in yesterday's class. We discussed generalization and association. How to represent the generalization concept and association concept in class diagrams and object diagrams. And what are the things we need to consider? And how to represent the generalization in case of multiple inheritance and multi-level inheritance. Okay, our next topic is, so in a, we saw an example also how to represent the following situations using class diagram using generalization and association concept. So like in an organization, we have employees of three different categories like professional staff, technical staff and support staff. In that case, how we can represent them using a generalization concept. The same way, we can represent a media player. In a media player project, we have three different types of recordings like sound and image and sequence of images. In that case, how to represent the generalization using three different types of similar classes. So our next topic is called object diagrams. You know very well, objects are instance of the class or members of the class. And objects are runtime entity. They are dynamic in nature. They take different values during different occurrences. So the values of whenever we create an object, the corresponding constructor class will be executed, and the constructor will initialize the memory space, initial memory allocation for the all class members as well as member functions within the class. So the whenever we come out from the program, if you are not storing the objects in a permanent file or in a data storage, in that case, the objects will be destroyed by calling the corresponding destructor function. So we have default constructor and destructor functions, or we can initialize our own constructors and destructors so that whenever we initialize objects from a class, the corresponding constructors and destructors will perform allocation and deallocation of memory space for the objects. So how we can represent object diagrams? So object diagrams or a link is an instance of an association. In the same way that we say an object is an instance of a class. So we know very well, objects are instance of class or members of the class. And while representing the objects in our UML diagram, how we'll represent means, say for example, we have an employee class, so we are initializing different employees. So we are create employee, we have employees of different types. So we are creating objects of employee class Pat, Vaini, Corp and O Corps, Ali. So from the employee class, we are creating different objects or different people or members of the employee class. So while representing the object diagram, we will take the same rectangle symbol. The object name will be specified, and so within the object diagram also, how association and generalization in our objects we can represent in object diagram. Associations describe the relationship that will exist between instance at the runtime. So how the objects are associated with each other within the objects can be represented using object diagram, and the association among the objects can be represented during the based on the interaction between the objects. The association among the objects will be represented. When you show an instance diagram generated from a class diagram, where we will be an instance of both classes joined by an association. So within the class or class itself, we are specifying generalization and association. The same way, the objects belongs to the different classes can be associated or generalized based on the class derivations. and generalization describe relationship between classes in their class diagram. They do not appear in instance diagram at all. An instance of a class should also be considered to be an instance of each of the class superclasses. So in a generalization is already specified in the classes. So if you create instance or objects of the different classes, so no need to specify the generalization among the objects itself, because in the declaration part of the class itself, we are specifying which is the base class, which is a derived class, and how they are, whether they are siblings or they are from different levels of the parent class or grandchild children class, that is specified already using generalization concept in class. So no need to specify the generalization in objects. So we started with the object diagrams. Objects are instance of the class. So the runtime nature of the objects can be represented using object diagram, and the objects are created during the runtime. So the base class is specified along with the objects, and in objects also we can specify the association among the objects that specify how the objects are associated with each other during the runtime. That is, if you are performing any operator overloading concept, in that case we will perform the addition, subtraction and other arithmetic and logical operations on the objects. That can be represented, the various association, how the data is transferred among the objects can be represented using association in object diagram. But generalization, we already specifying the generalization, the inheritance and polymorphism concept using classes itself in the declaration part itself. So no need to specify explicit explicit generalization in object diagrams. So the next advanced features of class diagrams. So in class diagrams, we can specify other advanced features like aggregation and aggregation hierarchy, composition, propagation, interfaces. So these are the four additional advanced features which we can specify in object diagrams. So we know very well, aggregation means it is aggregation or the average or the overall superclass for the given set of subclasses. So aggregation are special associations that represent a pothole relationship. So I think you might have already studied in the DBMS itself, easier relationship and part of relationship. The PPT screen is visible to you. Where do we ask?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, this screen is visible to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, what you are seeing in the screen?
Advanced features of class diagram.
Yeah, aggregation. Can anybody say what is aggregation? The same mathematical term what we are using in mathematics. Aggregation means it represents the aggregate or average, or we can say we will take, say if you have 10 items, so we will take all 10 items, then we will try to generalize whether all the 10 items are belongs to the same category or not. So the same way the object oriented programming, we are using classes and objects. In that case, we have so many classes, say if you have some super class, or we can say the parent class, and we have so many derived classes. In that case, we need to aggregate which is the base class and which are the base class parameters, attributes and functions, and which are all the classes will come under the subclasses, and what are the special characteristics that should be specified in the subclasses. Say for example, if you take the vehicle, in general vehicle class is an super class, and the vehicle parts, say the handlebar, seat, accelerator and other light and other parts, the various parts of the vehicle, it may be two wheeler or four wheeler, the various parts of the vehicle all together aggregated, and we will represent it as an vehicle. So the vehicle is generalized class. From the generalized class vehicle, we can have different vehicle parts classes. So here the aggregation is represented using the decision making symbol, or we can say the diamond symbol. So the diamond symbol, previously generalization is represented using triangle symbol. The hollow triangle is used to represent the generalization in class diagrams. The same way we will use the diamond symbol. Four corners will have four corners. Diamond symbol is used to represent aggregation. It means that the various vehicle parts all together aggregated, all belongs to the superclass called vehicle. The same way we have a country. So within the country we'll have so many regions: north region, south region, east region, west region, middle region. So the four regions or five regions of the northeast region, like that. So the various regions of the country all together belongs to the same class called country class. So the aggregation is represented using the diamond symbol. It's a hollow diamond symbol. So and the relationship between the country and the region subclass is, so within one country we'll have n number of regions. So it may be four regions or eight regions or 16 regions, depending upon the borders of the country. So the whole and we will say the aggregation represents the whole part of relationship. So the whole side is often called the assembly of the aggregate. So the various assembled parts all together belongs to the same the vehicle. The symbol is a shortened notation association named called east part relationship. So this diamond symbol is called east part of relationship. As a general rule, you can mark an association as an aggregation if the following are true. So in association also, the different classes and how they are associated with each other is represented. The same way in aggregation also, the various parts or subclasses, how they are belongs to the superclass is represented. The parts of the aggregate, or the aggregate is composed of the parts. So we can say the regions are, all regions are composed of, composed together we will get the full country. Or the various parts or parts all together belongs to the same vehicle. So you got the idea what is aggregation, how we are representing aggregation. So we are taking two different the various classes. If the classes are associated with each other through the inheritance or friend relationship, so how the second class is related with the first class, or the superclass is how associated with the subclass, can be represented using aggregation symbol. Aggregation symbol is a diamond symbol, hollow diamond symbol, and we can specify the multiplicity on the association. So here the so many vehicle parts all together belongs to the one vehicle. So one to many relationship is specified in aggregation. So these are these notations we need to use. So say you are creating one class, we are creating one more class, and if they all belongs to the second class is derived from a base class, then we need to use this association symbol. And while selecting the association itself, you should select the aggregation symbol, because we'll have so many vehicle parts. And then after choosing the association aggregation symbol, we need to specify the multiplicity above the aggregation. So here the multiplicity is one into many, many to one relationship. Say for example, here the class diagram is specified. We have the class vehicle. So the vehicle class is having the subclasses called chassis, body panel, door. So they are all the main sub derived classes. All three classes aggregated, aggregation symbol is specified, belongs to the base class. And again within the chassis we have frame, engine, transmission and wheel. So all three sub parts of the vehicle, all four parts of the vehicle aggregated belongs to the base class called chassis. And here the multiplicity is in a single one vehicle will have one chassis, it may have so many body panels and so many doors, front door, side door, left, right, all those things. The same way in the chassis itself will have the other sub parts called frame, engine, transmission, and will have more than one wheel. So the relationship all aggregated together belongs to the chassis base class. And here the base class and derived class relationship is one frame, one engine for one vehicle and one transmission, and it will have more than one vehicle. So you got the idea how we are representing the aggregation hierarchy. So So the diamond symbol, hollow diamond symbol, is used to represent the aggregation, and within the aggregation we will specify the multiplicity also. The next property is called composition. A composition is a strong kind of aggregation. So if the it means that it, the derived classes are must, or it is a highly agreed relationship. If the aggregation is destroyed, then parts are destroyed as well. Say for example, building belongs to room. Say if you have single one building or one apartment, you'll have n number of rooms. And if it is a building, there will be some rooms. Without rooms, we cannot say it is a building. So the relationship between the building class and the room class is strong relationship. So we are using the composition. So in aggregation, we are using hollow diamond symbol. In composition, we are using solid or filled diamond symbol. So the difference between aggregation and aggregation is hollow diamond symbol. So we are using unfilled the diamond symbol in for to represent aggregation. So aggregation means part of relationship, and composition means without the sub derived classes, the subclasses cannot be represented. So the strong relationship is represented using composition. Two alternatives for addresses. Say for example, employee, he is having address. The same way the employee should have some address. So there we have an employee class. Within the employee class, we have an derived class called address. So the address should have, without address we cannot represent the employee, or without the ID of the employee we cannot represent the employee class. So the base class is employee, derived class is maybe a different types of employees. The each employee should have some address. So without the properties, the employee class cannot be represented. Got the idea what is composition and what is aggregation? The third property is called propagation, and mechanism where an operation is an aggregate, it is implemented by having the aggregate perform that operation on its parts. Propagation is aggregation, and inheritance is to generalization. Say for example, inheritance is an implicit mechanism. Propagation has to be programmed when required. Say propagation, say for example, we have a base class called polygon. Within the polygon class, we are creating line segment. So the line segment is part of the polygon. So within polygon, we'll have n number of line segment. So if you want to specify an explicit relationship between the base class and the derived class, in that case we go for propagation. So in propagation also, we are using the solid diamond symbol, and multiplicity will be depending upon the property. And here the polygon will have n number of line segments. And if you want to specify the polygon is having how many line segment, in that case we will go for propagation. And the fourth property is called interface. And interface describes a portion of the visible behavior of the set of objects. So interface means how the different objects are associated with each other. So the explicit relationship between the objects should be specified using interface. And interface is similar to class, except it lacks instance, variable, and implemented methods. Say for example, we have person, and the person the aggregation between the employee and person is n number of employees. All the employees are persons or human beings. And we have machine, and within machine we have different types of machine. One of the machine is called ATM machine. So the collection of machines together, different ATM machines put together, we call it as a base class machine. So here the aggregation is mentioned, and interface is cashier, withdraw the or deposit. Say if an employee is accessing an ATM machine, so the interface between the employee and the ATM machine is represented using dotted arrow lines. So this is aggregation, and this is interface. So the interface is implicit, then you will use dotted arrows, and if it is explicit, then we'll use the solid line. Say the person, and the person is an employee category, and machine, within machine we have ATM. So if the employee is a cashier, so here the person employee is cashier, his role is cashier, so that is mentioned using the interface is mentioned solid line, and within the machine ATM machine then the role is cashier, is the interface is cashier. So you got the idea, the interface describes how the way objects are interacting with each other during the runtime. So the interface should be mentioned using dotted lines or using solid lines depending upon the implicit or explicit association between the objects. So far we discussed the major characteristics of, we started with object diagram, then we how the association and generalization is specified in object diagram, then the advanced features like how to represent aggregation property in objects and aggregation hierarchy, how it should be represented, multiplicity, then how we'll represent the composition, so the solid diamond symbol, where should and propagation, how it should be represented, and the interface. So propagation, aggregation, composition, and interface, these are the four major attributes we need to consider while representing the objects while drawing the diagrams, and the multiplicities should also be specified. So the next subheading is called interaction and behavioral diagrams. So far the class diagram is a static diagram, object diagram or dynamic diagrams. Next, so far we discussed the attributes. Next, we are entering into interaction diagrams and behavioral diagrams. Interaction diagrams specify how the interaction is occurring among various components or various methods. And behavioral diagrams specify the sequence of activities or the state of a system during runtime. The behavioral pattern or the various transactional attributes are specified using behavioral diagrams. So within behavioral and interaction diagrams, we have subcategories. So we will have class diagrams, interaction diagrams specify the interactions, state diagrams specify the state of a system during runtime, and activity diagram is used to represent the activities or transactions during runtime. Component diagram specifies the subcomponents. Component diagram specifies the subcomponents, and deployment diagram specifies the various hardware, software, peripherals, and other associated components of our project. So the class diagrams describes classes and their relationships, and interaction diagram the behavior of systems in terms of how objects interact with each other, and interactive behavior is represented using UML by using sequence diagram and collaboration diagrams. And state diagrams and activity diagrams show the system, how the system behave internally. And component and deployment diagrams show how the various components of the systems are arranged logically and physically. So these are the four diagrams now we are going to discuss: interaction diagrams, state diagrams, activity diagrams, component and deployment diagrams. If you take interaction diagrams, so interaction diagrams are used to model the dynamic aspects of the software system. They help to visualize how the system runs. They show how the set of actors, objects communicate within each other to perform the steps of the use case. So in interaction diagram, we will take the various use cases and the various sequence of activities, functions, and how they communicate with each other during runtime depending upon the coding. Interaction diagrams can show several different types of communication. So it will show the communication among the classes, among the variables, how the call by reference, call by value, all the internal activities of our system, each and every line, how it is executed can be represented using interaction diagram. The following elements can be found in the interaction diagram. So while representing and drawing an interaction diagram, we should consider these two main characteristics: instance of class or actors. So how the classes are class objects are initialized, and how it is interacting, the actor should be represented. Instance of classes, that is objects, are shown as in boxes. So objects will use boxes with the class and object identifier underlined. So the object will be specified by underlining the object. Actors are shown using the same stick person symbol in the use case diagram. So the actors will be represented using stick figure. Stick diagram, stick figure will be used to represent the objects, and how the stick figure is used to represent the person or the actors, and the objects are represented using rectangle boxes, and the object name or the key parameter will be underlined. Messages are those shown arrows from the actor to object or from object to object. One of the main objective of drawing interaction diagram is to better understand the sequence of message. So we'll use the arrows, and above the arrows we will specify the labels. The labels are used to represent the it will give you the description about the interaction. There are two kinds of diagrams to specify the interaction. One is sequence diagram, another one is communication diagram. So if you take the interaction diagram, so the sequence diagram shows the sequence of activities, how each and every statement within the function or within the main program is executed. While executing each and every instruction, how the various activities are performed, that will be represented using sequence diagram. So it will show you the state of your process each and every second. Example of a student registration process, the actor initiates the interaction via the user interface. The user interface sends request to register. So here, to represent the sequence diagram, we are taking the student post registration process. The student is logging into the registration process. Then he will register himself, then log into the system. Then he will choose the course. He will go to the course section. Then he will register for a particular course. The registration object then asks the student to add it to the list of courses the student is taking, and also ask the course section to add it to the list of registered students. Once the student registered for a particular course, the particular course will be added to the student's registration section, as well as the student will be added to the student has already chosen the elective or chosen the particular course subject. So the diagram, so this is the sequence diagram that represents the student registration process. So here the user is student. The student is specified using stick figure. And the student, this is the starting state. The student is interacting with the system. He is requesting to register. So he is logging into the system. So the first query is request to register. So that is the first statement. So the request is sent to the course section. He is accessing the course section of the registration process. Then he create the registration. So he is filling the registration form. Once the form is submitted, they add to the registration list. So the course is added to the course section. The particular course is registered by the student. Then the same registration activity is added to the student function also. The course is added to the student list of courses. So the student is accessing, logging in. He is choosing a course. He is registering for the course. Once the course is registered by the student, that course is registered, added to the course section, as well as the same course is added to the student section. He is registered for the course. Yes, a simple sequence diagram shows the student registration process. So the sequence diagram will look like this. So the first activity is entering into the system. So here the symbols notations are different. We'll have the division that shows how the action is following. Here we are using the arrow symbol. The message is specified above the arrow, association. So this is one function. Registration is another function. Student is, they are all the objects. So we take the, here, course section is an object, registration is an object, student is an object. They are all specified in the rectangle symbols by underlining the object. So the same student course registration process, the corresponding class diagram is where we have the class diagram. Course is in one class, and within the class we have get prerequisite. Before registering for the course, we will check for prerequisite, whether the student has completed the prerequisite course. If he is he already completed the prerequisite course, then he is eligible for choosing the successor course. So then he will go for course section. course class, one course class can access n number of course section. So you can perform the operations like request to register, add to register, register. Then in the registration process, the same way the course section, one course section can access n number of registrations. The same way one student can access, you can register for n number of courses, 5 courses or 6 courses or 8 courses. So the student class can perform the operations like add to schedule, has paused the course. So these two functions will be performed before registration by the student. So the free request is seat is checked, then the student is accessing the registration process. Then once the course is registered, that is added to the course section as well as the student list. So this is the corresponding class diagram. For the same class diagram, how the sequence of activities are performed, that is presented using sequence diagram. So any doubt how we are creating the sequence diagram? So another sequence diagram is shown how the interaction between the various components. The diagram shows more detailed using graphical user interface, optional combined fragment as shown below. Say this student user is requesting to register. He is interacting with the GUI, graphical user interface. Then he is placing on request to register. That request is gone to the section of course section. Within the course section, we are checking whether the student has prerequisite. He has passed the prerequisite course. Then it will go to the register. Then he will be allowed into the registration process. So in the registration process, add to schedule. The particular once he registered the course, it is added to his timetable schedule and add to the registration list. The course is already chosen by the student, that also added to the course section. And so before adding to the course section, we will check whether he already passed the prerequisite. So this is one internal process. Within the internal process, we are creating the registration object, and the object is performing add to schedule as well as add to the course section. So once the student registered, then the course is allotted to the student. So the sequence of activities, so this is the first stage, second stage, third stage and fourth stage. And the student is interacting with the GUI interface, course section, student section as well as course object. So the flow of action is specified. Say the request to register, then he will go here, then it will go for prerequisite and get the requisite. Then it will, here itself you will check for the prerequisite. Again, the registration will be allowed. Within the registration, it will be added to the course section as well as it is added to the student section also. So the flow of action should be specified. Once the registration is over, he will come back to the GUI. Again, he will log out from the system. So the flow of sequence of activities is represented using sequence diagram. So again, so any doubt in the sequence diagram, how to draw the sequence diagram? Any doubt in the sequence diagram? The speed is visible to you. So we can create the sequence diagram using star UML also. The screen is visible to you. So if you open in the last class itself, we discussed how to install the star UML. So star UML is an open source software. Trial version is available, or you can buy the original version also. Star version, trial version will work for 3 months. Again, we need to reinstall. The screen is visible to you. So if you open star UML, we'll get the options. Want a default approach or a rational rows approach or UML components or empty object. So we'll go for a default approach. The screen is visible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, what you are seeing?
New project upload.
Yeah, star UML is screen is visible. Joshna?
Yes, approaches, open files, recent files.
Yeah, can you able to see the file, edit, format, model, store UML?
No, ma'am.
Now, store UML edit screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So if you install the store UML, you open the store UML, you will get the interface, that is edit screen. So last class itself, we checked within store UML, we can create all the UML diagrams. So if you go to model, we'll have all the options. And if you go to tools, we can create C++ program, C# program, or we can create the Java programs for the corresponding diagrams. The same way, we have view option. We can view different versions of the same diagram in various aspects. Say the output, we can view messages, we can view toolbox, we can view. So whatever you want to view in the edit screen, that you can choose from the view. In model section, we have collection editor, constraints, the constraints like multiplicity, public, private, protected, or a base class, derived class, and pure virtual function, that we can, various constraints on the classes and objects and functions can be specified. And the format we have, and the edit, we can do all the operations. So if you will start a new project, edit screen is appearing. So we can, within the main, we can have, we'll have various boundaries, associations, generalizations, those notations are available. And if you go for the, if you want to, within the project, if you want to create subsystem, or if you want to go for packages or classes, so if you choose classes, all the notations associated with the class will appear. Say if I choose class here, I am getting the various, say we can specify the class name, author, other things, the UML entities. The same way, if you choose interface, the interface among the classes can be represented. So there are various interfaces like association, direct association, aggregation, composition, generalization, dependency, what we discussed now. So the special features of which we can apply on classes and objects. Say the association among the classes, or direct association, aggregation class, and composition properties can be specified within the class and within the interface. And enumeration data types we can create, exceptions we can create. Say for example, we'll go for class. So we will draw on class. So if we click on class, and we'll get a class diagram. So here within the class diagram, we'll have three parts: first part, second part, and third part. First row is to represent the class name. Say for example, here we are specifying the class name as student. So a student class is created. So if you want to change the properties about the class, we can change. Then within the class name student, the student is created here. Here we'll add the, we can add the various attributes. So the various attributes of the class are, so we can, it may be a plus means public, minus means private. So here we're specifying the name of the student. You click, it will create additional classes. We'll create another class called course. So in sequence diagram, specify the sequence of activities. So we can change the name of the, we created three different classes. So one is the student class, another is a registration, third one is prerequisite. Course section. So in registration, we can add the properties as well as attributes. So the attributes here the attribute name is registration. Also they need to specify what are the things we will do in registration. We need to select the course. course name you will specify, and the operations you can add the operations like select the course, add course, you can add other attributes like operations like registration process will have add course. Confirm. Confirmation function. What are the operations you will do in the registration process? The operation we can add. Add course, delete course. Choose. So we have a class called registration. Within that, we have course name and three functions like add course, confirm course, and choose the course. And the prerequisite also, we can add properties as well as attributes. We'll add the attributes like the prerequisite also course code. Course name. And we'll add the functions like operations like check for completion, course completed or not. In the course section, we have attributes. We already had attributes. So the various attributes we had are course section. We have some functions. Now the functions like a department elective and we categorize open elective like that. So we'll add some attributes like the name of the student. USN number. Semester, which is semester year? Add operations like get data. Display function. So we had four classes. Now we can create the apply the association. Say if you choose the association, the student is associated with the student can access. The registration process. In the same way, in the course section, we have one more class. Four paper, four subjects. One more class. Elective subjects. So we can create the aggregation among So we need to specify so that the dependency screen is visible to you. Screen is visible to you.
Yes, ma'am. The star UML window is visible.
Yes. The same way you can try the. You got the idea how to create the classes using star UML. But anyhow, this semester you are not having the lab for. Next semester only. Seventh semester only you have. Software engineering and testing lab. In that, you will design all the class diagrams and object diagrams. You got the idea how to create the classes and how to specify the aggregation and generalization. So we need to set the property this as base class and this as a derived class. Then we can create the generalization and aggregation among the classes. So all our components will appear here. So we have main student class. So the student class should be specified as and we have course section, registration, prerequisite, classes. The same way, the course subjects we have. We should mention the course subject as an derived class. And this elective courses and course subjects are derived classes from course section. So we'll specify the relationship. So in the left hand side, we'll whatever classes we created, the classes will appear, and the corresponding attributes and functions will appear. And if you want to modify or edit, if you choose the particular elective course, the name of the course is elective course, and it's having visibility as public visibility, and it is an abstract class. So if you want to make it as an abstract base class, you can make it as, or we can choose this. core section, that you will make it as an abstract. So then it will become abstract. Now we can aggregate. The same way, elective subject also isn't, it's not an abstract one, it is a derived class. And the attributes are mentioned. We need to specify the details. It is a root class or leaf node. It is a leaf node. And here, core section is a root node. We need to specify it is a root node. And prerequisite is also a leaf node, because it is a derived class. And elective course also is an active class, or it is a template parameter, or is a specification. So this is, it is part of relationship. Active course also is a specification as well as it is a leaf node. Then we can specify the, once the constraints are fixed, then we can go for the association and okay, you also try yourself using downloading star UML, or you can try the same using virtual lab also. Got the idea? Okay, all of you answer your attendance. Okay, answer your attendance in the chat box. I will give you a simple small example. You try to execute the same using virtual lab. I will upload an assignment. Yesterday we tried an airline reservation system using virtual lab. Now the same you try using the website and take the snapshot, upload it in the Google Classroom. You got it? Keetana, are you there? Monica?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this week assignment is, yesterday we tried virtual lab IIT Kharagpur website now. So in that they given you two exercises based on use case diagram. So the first second experiment is drawing airline reservation system with passengers for booking the ticket, cancellation of ticket, rescheduling the ticket and check-in process. So the same exercise you try in virtual lab. After completing the diagram, you take the screenshot or you take the print screen, put it in a Word file. So how you are creating the classes, what are the users you are created, what are the use cases you created, then the associations you need to fix, then draw the diagram, take the snapshot, select the print screen and paste the print screen in the Word file, and you need to submit the same in the Google Classroom. You got the idea? So this will be your module 2 assignment. So every module you will have one assignment. So each module, each assignment carries 10 marks. So out of this, so we'll take the average of all the 5 assignments. So this week assignment is draw the use case modeling diagram for flight airline reservation system, you know, using virtual lab. Take the screenshot, paste it in the Word file and send it to me. Upload it in the Google Classroom. Okay, those who answered your attendance, you can log out or you can go to the next class. Any doubt so far? Go through the content and you try the same creating class diagrams, object diagrams using StorUML also. But anyway, this lab, this subject, course subject, you are not having the lab. But for your practice, for your understanding, you can try with virtual lab or you can try with StorUML or AgriUML or Umbrella. One more software is there, that also you can try. Shall we end the class? Samir, Shivani?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, all of you answered your attendance. Shall we end the class? I think only 66 people answered. Shall we end the class?